السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We always commence in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that He has bestowed upon us. We thank Him upon the goodness that He has granted us. We thank Him upon the challenges that He has placed in our lives. We seek His help to overcome those challenges. وأصلي وأسلم على أفضل الخلق وأكرم الرسل نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of creation, the most noble of all prophets, the one who was sent to us to teach us all this goodness. We indeed owe him a lot, and the minimum is for us to send blessings and salutations upon him at all times, whenever we can remember and whenever we say his name. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless his household, his companions, and every one of us and the ummah at large, my brothers and sisters in Islam. I have a topic to discuss today which is absolutely important for every one of us: the rights of the Muslim upon another Muslim. Now, you and I know that not everyone is related to you in the same way. Hence, the rights that need to be fulfilled would actually depend on how close you are in relationship. For example, if a person is a Muslim, or let's start off with someone who's not a Muslim. If a person is not a Muslim, they have rights over you. You need to help them, you need to reach out to them, you need to be honest and genuine, you need to be a person who cares, in the sense that a single life, as per the Quran, if you were to save a single life, it is as though you have saved entire humanity. That right is not just for a Muslim, but it is for a nafs, for anyone. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Whoever saves a single soul, a single person, no matter who they are, it is as though they have saved entire humanity. It goes to show how sacred life is. So that is even if a person is not a Muslim. But when a person is a Muslim, they are related to you in two ways. One is humanity, and two is they share the same faith. So we share the same maker. That's why I'm related to you. I tell you why, or I tell you how. Your brother or sister from your mother and father, how are they related to you, and why are they so important? Because you share a common parent or both parents. Agreed? If you have both parents in common, the relationship is far greater than if you were to have one parent in common, but that too is a great relationship. You are mahram. Mahram meaning you cannot marry each other. There are so many rights to be fulfilled, and the bond is you have one set of parents. What if you have one maker who made you? You are related. What's my relationship with the rest of the Jews and the Christians and the Hindus and the Buddhists and the whoever else? My relationship is, I believe I was created, and I believe that that creator created them too. That's my relationship. So I need to be concerned, I need to reach out to them goodness, I need to make sure that they are not harmed, there is no injustice happening, and at the same time I need to remind them of the maker, to say, you know what, we are made by the maker. Let's worship him alone. Whether they choose to do it or not, they are free, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, La ikraha fi al-deen, qad tabayyana ar-rushdu min al-ghayy. A beautiful verse just after Ayatul Kursi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is no compulsion when it comes to entry into the faith. You cannot compel someone. That's the test from Allah. So you cannot force someone to write an answer that they perhaps do not feel is correct. But it's their duty, it's definitely their duty to look into it, and it's our duty to make sure that we worship our maker alone. So that is how we are connected to them. We have the same maker. But if you have the same maker and the same parents, you are related in a stronger way. If you have the same maker and you are following the same set of rules and regulations and the same messenger, you belong to an ummah. So they have more rights It's not like the others don't have rights. And the reason I'm expanding on this for a few moments is because there are so many people who think that when we talk about the rights of a Muslim upon another Muslim, it means the non-Muslims have no rights whatsoever. That's why I'm telling you that non-Muslims do have rights. But the Muslims have more rights because there is a little bit more in common. Just like if someone was a Muslim and they were your neighbor, they have more rights. They have some unique rights because of the fact that they are your neighbors. If someone is a Muslim and they are your neighbor and they are related to you, they have even more rights. Subhanallah. So this is what we are saying. My brothers and sisters, let's try and understand that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, He created us in a certain way for certain reasons. And every time there is an opportunity to gain closeness to Allah through the way He made us. Amazing. So if Allah made you a certain color, certain race for example, certain nationality, you were born in a certain country, there are certain things that we had no say in whatsoever. That's a challenge. It's a test for you. What are you going to do about it? I always say, when Allah has given you, the test is, what will you do with it? When Allah has not given you, the test is, what will you do about it? I don't have, for example, wealth, or I'm not married, for example, or I don't have a qualification, whatever. Maybe I don't have something that others do have. What am I going to do about it? That's the test. And if I do have the money and the power and the everything else, what am I going to do with it? That's the test. When you have it, it's what are you going to do with it? When you don't have it, what are you going to do about it? And that's your test. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us pass our tests. So, the first thing that we always talk about when it comes to the Muslim is the name Islam. Islam means peace and it also means to submit. So he who submits to Allah, she who submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would definitely attain peace by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there is a greeting known as As-Salam as well. So you greet. As-Salamu alaykum. Subhanallah. And that greeting is so important that it is a guarantee to your fellow Muslim that you're not going to harm the Muslim. Now one might ask that, you know what about the non-Muslim? Can I not say Assalamu alaikum to them? And if they were to say Assalamu alaikum to me, what should I say? Well, I need to remind you of something beautiful, that it's not wrong to greet or to respond to a greeting, a cultural greeting, for example, with a non-Muslim. However, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were certain people who hated Islam and they hated him, and they used to change this greeting and use words that sounded similar but had bad meanings. For example, they would say Assalamu alaikum, which means death upon you. Now imagine, I'm innocently thinking that this man is saying Assalamu alaikum and they're just saying Assalamu alaikum, which means death upon you. And am I supposed to respond, and how am I supposed to respond? So Aisha radiallahu anha, she heard it, and when she heard this, she responded, "Wa alayka as-salamu wal-la'na." That means, yeah, you're saying death upon us, okay, and upon you, death and the curse of the Almighty. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, you know, he was sent as a mercy. He says, "Take it easy, O Aisha, relax, take it easy. If they say something of this nature, greet you, you just say, 'Wa alaykum.'" So if someone greets you and they say Assalamu alaikum, you're not sure, you just say Wa alaikum. That means, and you too. So if they say curse be upon you, you say, and you too. And if they say peace be upon you, and you too. So they would gain either way. This is a beautiful narration. The reason why I love it is it shows us how to react. Sometimes when a person does something bad, we react in a way that makes the problem bigger, compounds it. No, look at this beautiful narration. Easily, just say you too. Subhanallah. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ says, you don't have to start them with the greeting. You know, if I were to see someone who's not a Muslim, I can say hello, hi, good morning, how are you, what's going on, etc. All these greetings are fine. Assalamu alaikum is a sacred greeting. May peace be upon you. Yes. If I've heard it clearly from someone who's not a Muslim, I can respond it equally. I can respond it equally. Why? The Quran says, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَسِيبًا.
When you are greeted with a greeting, Allah didn't say who greeted you. When you are greeted with a greeting, so respond to that greeting in a better way. That's an instruction of Allah. When you are greeted with a greeting, respond in a better way. Or if you are not going to respond in a better way, at least in the same way. فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا, or at least reply it. Why? Because the end of the verse says something even more beautiful. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَسِيبًا. Indeed, Allah takes account of everything. So if you say, Assalamu alaikum, there is 10 rewards. وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ, another 10 rewards. وَبَرَكَاتُ, another 10 rewards. And if someone were to reply and just say, وَعَلَيْكُمْ, they get a very small reward for it. You're supposed to reply in the equal way or in a better way. Now, please, my brothers and sisters, let's understand something. To add to an Islamic greeting that which is not from amongst the Sunnah would be contradictory to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Because I have heard people say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. MashaAllah, sounds nice, okay? And then the other person says, Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu wa maghfiratuhu wa jannatuhu wa ridwanuhu. Wait, take it easy. The Prophet ﷺ would have gone well beyond that had it been. So you say, Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, as'alullaha lakal jannah. Now what did I do? I converted now into a dua. So I stopped at wa barakatuh, because the Prophet ﷺ stopped there, and I will continue with a dua for the person. May Allah give you Jannah, may Allah bless you, may Allah grant you good health, may Allah give you the best in the dunya and the akhirah. May Allah really give that to all of you. Ameen. And me too. So my brothers and sisters, that's a beautiful greeting. If someone has greeted me that way, I must reply it better or in the same way. This shows us when someone does good to us, we need to do better back to them, or at least don't harm them. At least do something similar. I'm going to say something personal, okay? Sometimes online, when I get a chance, I see some hate speech. Sometimes people who don't know you, they've not interacted with you, they don't know how you move around, they think perhaps you're eating the money of the people, they don't know how much you have spent from your own pocket for the da'wah, etc. They know nothing about you, and they start spreading hate. And when they spread this hate, you think to yourself, I think to myself sometimes, this sister, this brother, they don't know who I am. They have no clue who I am. Imagine, the only thing I've done is, I've helped them, I've tried to teach them, I've tried to reach out to them. And in return, instead of doing something better, which I don't even want, they cannot even do something equal, which, okay, I still don't want, but they cannot even remain quiet, which is the minimum I would like. Subhanallah. They want to say something negative. This is why nowadays we say, that your best friends are no longer those who help you. It used to be a few years ago. Your best friends are no longer those who help you. They are those who do not harm you. Trust me, the world has changed. Your best friends, if someone doesn't harm me, wallahi, that's a top person. They haven't spoken bad about me behind my back. When they've heard someone else speaking bad about me, they walked away. That was good enough. Even if they didn't have the power to defend, because people would say things. But to harm, be careful, my brothers and sisters. That's how shaitan traps us. So this is a right that we have over one another as Muslimin. To protect each other behind our backs is a right. Did you know that? Subhanallah, يَحُوطُهُ مِنْ وَرَائِهِ is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. A Muslim, for another Muslim, protects the one behind their backs without them knowing. Rather than that, today we do the opposite. I promise you, take a look at social media. We use it to cuss people. You know the meaning of the term cuss? We use it to harm, to say bad things, to make a mockery, and we're lying. And a lot of the times it's not a guided statement. It's totally misguided. We don't know the person we are referring to. And this is sometimes the reason why we suffer in our own lives, is because we are harming a friend of Allah. That's why we are suffering. So you have medical problems, family problems, financial problems, all other problems, and you still have hate. on your fingertips, when you catch your phone, when you hold your phone, a lot of hatred, and you're talking about this man and that woman and this sister and that one. Did you see her? She started covering. Who does she think she is? She thinks that Jibreel came to her in the night. Why do you have to say all of this? For what? By you making those statements. If someone wants to cover, let them cover. If you have not got to that point, no problem. We respect you as a human, as a Muslimah perhaps, and we know everyone has weaknesses. Perhaps you will work on it. But don't prevent someone else from getting closer to Allah. I have had cases where, forget about the rights of Muslim upon Muslim, but the father, the mother, they tell the daughter that, you know, why are you putting on a scarf on your head? You're going to cause problems for us. Take it off, remove it. And this is happening more and more, especially in the Western countries, where parents are forcing their children not to be close to Allah, even though the child is strong enough and says, you know what, I don't mind if people laugh at me, joke at me, I really don't mind if I'm picked, you know, at an airport for random searching, because random means Muslim, you know that. I was asked once, what's your name, at an airport. I almost said Mr. Random, but I left it. I left it. But I don't mind, honestly. So if that's what my little payment to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, that I'm going to be called out for 1 hour, questioned, it's my opportunity to give da'wah to the same person. I swear, I'm looking at him thinking, please stop me, man. Stop me. I need to get the message across to you, man. Subhanallah, I need to talk to you. I need, please. And when the brother says, you make proceed. And I'm like, just punctured my balloon here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. It all depends on how you look at it. Some people, they say, sorry sir, we'd like to search you. What? Because I'm a Muslim. What do you think? That's not the right way to react. Go back to that hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. Mahlan, mahlan, relax, take it easy. Think about it. It's your chance, your opportunity. Allah wanted it that way. They're going to hold you here for 12 hours. It's going to be your opportunity. Once I had a really big problem, okay, without getting into details, but not too long ago. So I walked through and they told me, listen sir, X, Y and Z, meaning they read out whatever they had to read out to me, and they told me what was to happen. And I was so calm. It was with an airline, and I was so calm and I was relaxed, and I looked at all these sisters who were there, subhanallah, my sisters in humanity. And what happened is, they were telling me, and I was calm, and I know the instruction is not from them, it's coming from somewhere above. What we do, we become upset and angry with a person lower down who's got nothing to do with the whole thing. And I was so calm and I was smiling until one of them commented to say, you are the first person whom this has happened to. And you're just smiling. I said, you know why? Because I believe in the Maker. And I believe if I'm not meant to be in a certain place at a certain time, the whole world can try to get me there and I will not be there. And I believe that if I'm meant to be here talking to you, then that's what it is. And I can stand here for how many hours? I'm not worried. I really am not worried. Because I've tried my best and that's it. And we will still try our best. So anyway, we were delayed for 2 days somewhere. 2 days. I promise you, 2 whole days. And guess what I did? I was just, hello, how are you? What's happening, guys? I went back the next day and the same thing happened and I was just, okay, no, that's fine, it's okay. Look, we're going to try, it's not your fault. Wallahi al-Azim, I hope and I pray that the mark that was left was actually a mark for Islam and the Muslims. To say that there are people who have proper character and conduct. I'm very far from perfection, nowhere near there. But it's one aspect that I tried to practice upon, and I'm sure there was a mark left. I promise you. These are the rights we have over one another. As a Muslim, you need to, I'm not going in any order here because I'm saying what's coming to my mind right here and right now, although I do have a list in front of me. As a Muslim, you need to choose the best possible words when you are speaking to one another regarding anything, because Allah speaks about the non-Muslims in the Quran, and Allah speaks about the people of the book. You know, the people of the book referring to the Jews and the Christians. And Allah says in that regard, ادْعُ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Call to the path of your Lord with wisdom. With wisdom. And with the best speech, the best reminder. Allah is talking about how you're supposed to be calling the non-Muslims towards Islam. And then Allah says, when you present your argument, جَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنْ. Present your arguments in the best possible way. So the question I have is, if we are supposed to be talking to the Jews and the Christians and the others who are not Muslim in the best possible way, using the best examples, using the best words, what do you think is our duty towards one another? That's the question. Simple logic. One another, the hadith says, Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi. A true Muslim is he or she whom all the others are safeguarded from the evils of his tongue and his hand. No verbal abuse at all. No bad words at all. No physical abuse at all. That is referring to the other Muslimin. Subhanallah. Imagine within your own home, your neighbors, your relatives, those who work for you, those whom you work for, your colleagues, the others whom you meet in the masjid, those who are right here, right now. What is your duty towards them? Wallahi, you're not allowed to harm them, abuse them physically, verbally, at all. You're not allowed to say one word that would be hurtful to them, even if you are correcting them. You may want to correct me. I may want to correct you. I need to do it in such a way that you feel so honored to be corrected regarding the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what it is. You need to feel the honor. If I'm telling you, my brother, you are wrong, I don't say, hey, you know nothing. You're going straight to hell. That's what some people are saying. They come to Muslims who pray 5 times a day, who read the Shahada. We might have a few differences of opinion. And they come and say, you're a kafir. What did you say? That is strange. Subhanallah. How could you utter those words? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says quite clearly that you're not supposed to say a single word that is abusive, that is harmful to one another. So I want everyone to look into their hearts right now, right here, and to promise yourself between you and Allah that you and I, we will improve the way we speak to our spouses, to our children, to our brothers and sisters, to our family members, to our parents, to our in-laws, whoever else. In-laws, subhanallah. Every time we speak about in-laws, may Allah forgive us. No, recently I've been asking all along that why do they say law? Where does the law come in? You know, is there something so bad that we're planning that we have to speak about law? In law. Couldn't they have a better word like in love or something? You know? So that's my father in love, you know? Imagine that's my mother in love. Wow! Allahu Akbar! That would be amazing. Because you know, if you want to develop a slightly Indian accent, maybe you might say instead of law, they instead of love, they say law. So maybe perhaps it could happen. But no, someone answered recently. They told me, you see, you have a father, he becomes a father-in-law. You have a son, he becomes a son-in-law. You have a daughter, she becomes a daughter-in-law. You have a mother, she becomes a mother-in-law. You have a wife, what does she become? She is the law. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Anyway, as Muslimin, we don't face that problem, alhamdulillah. We don't face it at all. Because for us, it's in love, inshallah. We're in love, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless my father in loves and my mother's in love, mashallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. My brothers and sisters, I spoke about the greeting. I spoke about how important it is not to harm people. How important it is when Allah says, "Hal jaza'u al-ihsan illa al-ihsan." Is the recompense of goodness anything besides goodness? Surah Ar-Rahman. Immediately after that, Allah says, "فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Which is it of the favors of your Lord do you deny? Subhanallah. The recompense of goodness, is it anything besides goodness? The answer is no, it is goodness. A lot of us, we don't recompense goodness with goodness. Rather, we recompense it with hurt, with hate. with enmity, with destruction, disunity. And that's what it is. Someone did good to you all your life. And at the end of the day, all you did is threw it straight out of the window. Nothing. Someone tried to teach you, reach out to you. People did things, you know, and that's it. A person cooks for you. A person cooks for you. And they spent hours on end preparing the meal. And the only thing you could do was to pick on what was wrong. That's what we do. Rather than saying, imagine you have a dish and you or the person who cooked forgot to put some salt. You see, I heard salt coming from the crowd. They know it has happened. It's normal. I think Allah makes it happen because it might be coincidental for us. For Allah, there's no coincidence. He knew it was going to happen. Before you were born, it was already written. This day, this time, there will be no salt. We'll be watching. The angels will be writing. And as you put the food in your mouth, the angels are writing. And they just see your reaction, pass or fail. Allahu Akbar. So if you were to taste it and say, imagine the tick you get. 10 out of 10. Subhanallah. Say, this is absolutely lovely. How long did it take you to make this? Wow. You can say, you can quietly bring a bit of salt. You know, I prefer a little bit more salt. Wow. You looked after someone's feelings. That's what you did. You looked after a person you care for, you love perhaps. Even if it was a paid cook, at least you didn't hurt their feelings. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. Okay, let's move on quite quickly. So there are so many narrations that make mention of various rights that we have over one another. So in one narration, there is a mention of five all in a row. That does not mean that the only rights that we have over one another are these five. But these five were mentioned all at once, at one specific time for a reason. Just like when we say, who are the people who will be going to paradise and who have already been told in their lifetime that you are going to paradise, people might say, there are 10. There are not 10. There are so many, but 10 were mentioned once in one narration. That doesn't mean that they were only 10. The same applies to the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know 99 have been mentioned in one specific narration, but Allah has many more names than that. Now, if you were to memorize 99 out of all of the names, that's good enough. So this is just a way of explaining that the rights go well beyond five. But what are these? When you are greeted, you respond the greeting. So to greet is a sunnah, but to reply is a farad. What that means is to greet is voluntary, but to reply is compulsory. One might say, how come? Because the response is actually what was dictated in the Quran, and I've already read the verse for you. It's dictated by Allah. When you are greeted, greet back. That's an instruction. I cannot change it. It's farad. Compulsory, Allah says it. So that's what it is. Then we have, if a person invites you, you need to respond to the invitation. They invite you for food. You have to respond if you're a believer. It's one of their rights, but this is not a farad right, which means some scholars say if it is a wedding, what is known as walima, and if it is done properly according to the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the do's and don'ts are taken care of, and you have no valid excuse, then you have to go. There's no option. You have to go. That's what some of the scholars say. But a lot of them say, look, it's recommended to go. It's recommended to go. And if there is something wrong happening, you cannot go. Now, how do we understand this? We are seated here in the midst of, I think, a little bit more than a few thousand people here. Imagine you were to invite me and say, you have to come. I can only go to one person's house, or I can only enjoy a meal with one group of people. It's possible. What about the rest? They will all write you hate mail. We came, you went to the rich people's house, you didn't come to the... Everyone uses their own excuse, you know. It's just a cheap way of explaining who we are sometimes. So you have to find an excuse for the person as well. If they cannot respond to your invitation, you need to know that there is a valid reason. And you don't need to know the reason sometimes. If they say, look, I cannot make it, say, no problem. That's it. That's also a right. To understand when someone presents an excuse. To understand. Don't become dirty. Don't become hard. You know, people say, I know, I've tasted this. People say, you only go to the rich and famous. That's because you don't know. You don't live with me. My life, perhaps, the bulk of it, is with those who are way, way below the general level of the poor person in your country. Subhanallah. And this is honest. So what? I don't need to explain that to the world. But if you hate me as a result and you think, you know what? This guy didn't come, this person didn't respond, like I was invited to a certain masjid and I couldn't go because I didn't have the time. I had a duplicate appointment and I excused myself and I got such a nasty mail, I'll never forget it. It's not like I have not forgiven, but I won't forget it. You know, this business of forgive and forget, it doesn't work. I don't know if you've ever heard forgive and forget. We will forgive, but we will remember it. Because the hadith says, لَا يُلْدَغُ الْمُؤْمِنُ مِنْ جُحْرٍ وَاحِدٍ مَرَّتَيْنَ. A true believer is never bitten from the same source twice. So if you forgot, you're going to be bitten again. So to say forgive and forget, sometimes it's a way of blackmailing people, I think. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. But what is meant perhaps by forget is not that you don't remember the incident, but you have forgotten, you've tried your best perhaps to forget the hurt that it caused, or maybe to forget things that you might have thought you're going to do in return and whatever else. But forgiveness, definitely we cannot compromise. That is definitely encouraged very, very strongly in Islam. That's also one of the rights. One of the rights is for us to forgive one another as far as possible. Learn to forgive. Learn to forgive. Okay, so if a person invites you, we respond to the invitation. Then, when someone sneezes and they praise Allah, Alhamdulillah, for you to respond to that with a dua for them is a right they have over you. So if I sneeze right now and I say Alhamdulillah and you've heard it, it's your duty to say Yarhamukallah, may Allah have mercy on you. Because sneezing is a gift of Allah. It has perhaps deflected or held back some form of bacteria or disease or anything else that may want to get into your system, foreign objects or bodies, whatever, and you sneeze, you need to say Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah. And the person who hears that, it's their right, it's their duty to say Yarhamukallah or Yarhamukillah if you're a female, if the one sneezing was a female. Why? Because we should thank Allah upon the goodness of someone else. And that's why going straight into another right that we have amongst one another, that we fail a lot of the times, is to be happy at the happiness of another and to be sad at the loss of another. That's a right. لَا تَظْهَرِ الشَّمَاتَةَ لِأَخِيكِ. Don't ever become pleased at the loss of your brother. Why? Because there is a chance يَرْحَمُهُ اللَّهُ وَيَبْتَلِيكِ. Allah might have mercy on that person and test you with the same. So don't show like you're excited. You know, you hear that someone suffered a loss. You say, yes, I'm glad. They deserved it. Not at all. Someone passed away. Ooh, finally. May Allah forgive us. You don't say that. No matter what. When there is a loss, you need to make sure that you definitely feel the pain. Even if the degree is small. But you're a human, and on top of that, you're a member of the Ummah. So that is one of the rights. And how do we know this? It comes and it stems from the issue of when you sneeze and you say Alhamdulillah, there should be a response with the dua Yarhamukallah. And there should be a response again coming from the sneezer to say Yahdikumullahu wa yuslihu balak. May Allah guide you and improve your affairs. This is something that is beautiful. Have you noticed in Islam, it's filled with supplication from the beginning. When I see you, assalamu alaikum, that's a supplication I'm praying. For who? For you. Sneeze, supplicate. You supplicate for me. We're supplicating for one another. Yarhamukallah. Rafa Allahu qadrak. May Allah increase you in status. Ghafar Allahu lak. May Allah forgive you. These are words that we should be saying to one another. Because when I say a prayer for you, the angels are saying Ameen for me with the same prayer. Or they are saying, oh Allah, grant him the same. Or her. So this is why we keep on praying for one another. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on every one of us. Then, when a person is sick and ill, it's important for us to visit them. It's important for us to show concern because they are on a low. And this is why we say your expression, the expression on your face, wallahi my brothers and sisters, can be an act of worship if it is correct. Because I promise you, people sit gloomy. Yesterday, Sheikh Asim was saying, who is older? By the way, he's already a grandfather of 9 children. Subhanallah. But I wanted to say that how you carry yourself can actually keep you young. If you scrunch up your face every day, you start developing creases on your face at 30. And people look at you and think you're 50. Why? Because every day you look at the world and you're scrunched up. But if you have a face whereby your expression is pleasant, wallahi, you won't age so quick by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason is you have a pleasant face. And that's why even if you are 50, you don't look it. The reason is, you know, that's it. You smile most of the times, you know, and you'll be lucky if your name is a smile as well. My brothers and sisters, I'm honest with you. Your expression is very important. It will uplift people. People who are looking down, they are sad, and you walk in and you smile at them. It uplifts them. Even someone who's angry with you and they say, you know what, you are this and that, and you just look at them and they have no option. It is contagious. They look at you, they say, you're mad, and they'll walk away. That's it. But it's so powerful. It's a right we have to the expression to make someone feel uplifted in a beautiful way is a right. It's really a duty. And where do we get that from? We get it from the hadith which says to smile at the face of your brother is a charity. That means you need to make sure you smile. It may not be compulsory, but it will definitely enhance the relationships within the ummah. And I promise you, the others who watch us will definitely say, look at these people, they're so happy. But I might have more problems than you. I might have more problems than you. That's the beauty of Islam. So when a person is sick and ill, you visit them. But you need to know how long you've got to visit them for. You don't just go with your picnic basket early morning and say, I want to do an ibadah. There's a hadith which says, if I come to you, I'll find Allah. So I'm going to sit all day and I'm going to be here. They get more sick. Subhanallah. Especially when they watch you eating your pies and they cannot eat. And drinking your coconut juice. Or coconut water, as it were, and they cannot drink. So you need to go for a minimum time. When you're visiting the sick, go for the least possible time unless they request your company. Did you hear that? That's a sunnah. And you need to make sure it is a convenient time. You don't go at any time and every time and start thinking, they must wake up, I'm here. Wake your father up, I'm here. The man had an operation. The man is ill and sick, he's seated. Who are you to come there and say, Iyadatul Marid, here's the hadith, Haqqul Muslimi ala al Muslim, it's the right of a Muslim, I'm here to engage in this act of worship. You cannot send me back. You cannot send me back because it's my duty to be here. Not at all. Then if it was me, I would read a verse of the Quran where Allah says, وَإِن قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا وَأَزْكَى لَكُمْ. When you are told to go back, it's better for you. A verse. So we need to know when to go. We need to know how long to go for. Today we have the phone. Not only about the sick, but even if you were to visit someone, please make an appointment with them. Please message them. Make sure they're expecting you. Because today, the woman needs a minimum of 1 hour before she can open the door. In some cases. So if you were to just pitch up at the door, chances of you standing there and waiting for... You'd rather have phoned earlier or messaged earlier to say, you know what, I'm going to be making it here. Same applies to someone who's sick and ill. You don't just pitch up and you don't come at 2 in the morning and so on. This is why the hospitals have a visiting time. Because you're supposed to be resting at the hospital. And this is why it's considerate to let the family members know that, you know what, I'd like to come, but I'll come when they're feeling a little bit better. Because I promise you, recently I had a relative who was not too well. And this person said to me, you know what? I'm tired of repeating the same thing. Because people are coming and saying, what happened? They say 2 words, what and happened. And I've got to speak for 20 minutes because I've got to explain to them what happened. So I said, why don't you say it once? I'll record it. When someone says, what happened? Just say, hang on. Press the button. Do you hear what happened? Okay, here we are. May Allah forgive us. This is a Muslim. A Muslim is considerate towards another person. My brothers and sisters, this is so interesting, but I need to move, inshallah. I need to continue. By the way, I spoke in detail about sickness and about visiting the sick in my Jumu'ah talk, and it's been uploaded onto Muslim Central and various other platforms, and inshallah the talk will be available at some stage, even the video of it, I think, inshallah. So you can look into that. Then, if a person passes away, we all say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. But to follow that janaza, to show an interest in it, to go and express condolences, sympathy, say a little dua for them, to make them feel good. Just like when a person is sick and ill, if you were to say, may Allah bless you, may Allah grant you goodness, may Allah cure you. These are good words. They enhance the person's feelings. You don't go there and say, hey, you're not looking well, man. How long have the doctors given you? 2 days. Hey, I think you might just go in a day. When someone passes away, you don't say, your son was on drugs. Hey, I wonder what's going to happen now. Because you see, in the grave, there's a big punishment happening, you know. When someone passes away, you don't talk like that. You give the people hope. You say, inshallah, may Allah give them Jannatul Firdaus. No matter who they were, may Allah grant them Jannah. Subhanallah. When someone is alive, you can speak about hellfire, you can speak about the warnings and so on. Not when they're about to die. When they're about to die, I spoke about it the other day, you can hear it, inshallah. But you don't say that. But generally, if I were to talk to you now and remind you, look, we need to do good because there is heaven, there is hell and so on. It's good to talk. It's good to remind each other about what's happening. And it's good to remind each other the goodness so we can work towards it, and the bad so that we can protect ourselves from it. But when someone's passed away, go there. Minimum time again. Don't just sit there and expect food. I know in some cultures across the world, not just in this part of the world, but a lot of places, it's very expensive to die. Because when someone dies, they put up a tent in the house. They have food that they prepare for how long? They, you know, Intercontinental comes and do catering. Such that people are looking, hey, tell us. There's a WhatsApp group of deaths. So we need to know where people have died so we can go and eat. I hope that doesn't happen here. But I promise you, it is happening in some communities. We've converted it into a punishment. Someone passes away, it's so tough on the family members. Someone is sick and ill. When you go, make it clear that you don't want tea or anything. You settle for water, if anything. You are going, what are you here for? You know, I have this problem at my home where the little office that I have, people come sometimes with their problems and issues. So when people come, we are polite, you know, and I talk. It's like a doctor's surgery, for example. They'll come with their issues. My mother always comes and says, ask them, will they have tea or coffee or whatever? And I'm like, they didn't come for tea or coffee. They didn't come for tea or coffee. Leave them. And because my mother is, you know, still of that generation whereby she feels, no, these are your guests. You've got to honor them. You have to give them. And I'm thinking, if that's the case, I'm going to be one of the biggest buyers of coffee and tea. And there's going to be a tent here. People will come in, even if they don't have a problem. Let's go and have some tea. Because that's how the world's become. So when you go to someone for a purpose, make sure you make it clear. I'm not having anything to eat or drink. I've just come here for 2 minutes, 5 minutes, and then leave after that. The worst guest is he who doesn't know when to go. That's the worst. Ask the women, they'll tell you. Because they've got children sometimes, they need to get up the following morning, the kids sometimes sleeping, not sleeping, and you're busy sitting there enjoying yourself, talking, watching TV, watching a boxing match, watching a football match. That's not the quality of a Muslim. Consideration is a word we need to start enacting. Consider, be considerate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So when a person passes away, to follow the janaza for the men, to actually go to the graveyard and to bury the person, great reward, because it reminds you of who exactly you are, where you came from and where you're going. Primarily, that's the reason. And the secondary reason is, someone somehow, somewhere needs to bury a person who passes away. If we were to all give so much importance to it, then at least nobody would just be left alone without anyone burying them, because it is fardu kifaya, which means someone, somewhere, somehow has to do it. If one person, or if those who are required to fulfill the burial, the minimum number, do not do it, then the entire community is sinful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us the day we pass away and have mercy on us. Then, when a Muslim asks you for advice, you need to be genuine. You need to give them proper advice. You need to be genuine. Not like someone says, you know, I want to marry this person. What do you think? I wanted to marry them too. I think she's a very bad person.
I really believe that's a no-go area. Please don't go there.
Why? Why are you lying? You know, just be honest and say, well, I was thinking of the same girl. So I'm a good Muslim. And I'm sure you're a better Muslim. So you know what to do, right?
SubhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Anyway, my brothers and sisters, when engaging in goodness, it's our duty to help. Because Allah says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى.
Help each other when it comes to righteousness and God consciousness. That which is good, help each other. If I were to help you to fulfill goodness, we want to go to the lecture, let's go together, I'll give you a lift, we want to go to the masjid, we want to do this, do that. But when it comes to evil, it's my duty not to assist.
Even if it's to pass the alcohol bottle from that side of the table to here, it won't happen. It won't happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Ameen.
Then to seek forgiveness for one another is also a duty. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, forgive my father, forgive my mother, forgive the ummah. And this is why if you look at the du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he makes du'a for the ummah. وَغْفِرِ اللَّهُمَّ لِجَمِيعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ الْأَحْيَاءِ مِنْهُمْ وَالْأَمْوَاتِ. I'm sure you've heard that, a lot of you, right? What is it? It's a prayer for everyone. Those who have passed away, those who are alive, the entire ummah, oh Allah, forgive them so you can also be forgiven. That's also one of the rights. Now when we say rights, some of them are compulsory and some of them are recommended. They're voluntary. But recommended meaning your life would be enhanced if you were to fulfill some of these rights and if you were to understand them and become more conscious of them. I spoke about forgiveness and I'd like to speak about character and conduct. To develop your character and conduct is a duty that you owe one another. Because it is huququl ibad. It's part of the rights of the rest of mankind and the rest of the worshippers, the rest of the Muslimin. Imagine if your character is not refined, what would happen? People would be suffering because of the way you carry yourself. How selfish we become. And this is why a selfish person will never contribute to community in a positive way. We need to become selfless to a certain extent. In moderation. Moderation meaning you don't give away everything such that you are now in need. And you don't keep everything that you're just watching the people in need. But a balance. This is why when the Prophet ﷺ explains about charity, he tells Mu'adh ibn Jabal to tell the people that at a certain point, once you have accepted Islam, there is something known as zakah, that is a pillar of Islam. تُؤْخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِهِمْ فَتُرَدُّ فِي فُقَرَائِهِمْ. There is a right that the poor people have in the wealth of the wealthy. Did you know that? There is a right. And this is why when you give people who are poor in your society, community, and you have a massive business, they will pray for you because they know when they walk past your store and they see this big place, mashallah, they say, oh Allah, help this man. Let him do well because some of that money comes to me. 2.5% shares in that business. SubhanAllah. The poor have 2.5% shares in your business. Do you know that? That's from Allah, whether you knew it or not. They are partners. The only thing is, it's up to you to give. And you make sure you give the people. I know, I have a habit. When I know that this person actually gives out in charity, I make sure I go to that business and I make sure that I pay fully and I make sure that I buy as much as I can and I need from that particular business because I know where the money is going. It's a habit. And you know, there was a time when, you know, it says here to respect the scholars and ulama is also a duty we have for the ummah, because if we don't respect the scholars, the ummah loses value for those scholars. And who then is going to give you your deen? Who then is going to give you your faith and your religion? But we need to realize that scholars are not prophets. They may make mistakes. So correct them in a beautiful way. Or at least excuse them if that mistake doesn't need proper correction. Sometimes they may be a little bit temperamental. You might have a scholar who comes in here, he's been upset because of what happened at home. And sometimes it reflects. Some people can hide it, you know. Some people can hide what has happened in the morning. SubhanAllah. But others cannot hide it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. I need to share with you something. So I was waiting for my lift here just now a few minutes ago before I came here. And the brother had driven to the hotel and he had gone to do something. And I knew that this talk begins. So we were sitting in this vehicle and waiting. I tried calling this one, tried calling that one, but I don't have all the numbers of all the relevant people, and I did not want to disturb, you know, some of the senior guys to say small things like a vehicle. When I saw that now there's just enough time to get here, I decided to jump on the driving seat and turn on the TomTom, you know, the Garmin, and I typed out Matrade. I got my friend who was with me to type it out, and I just drove off, and we came here. I came on my own. How did that happen? And then they phoned me, Sheikh, where are you? I said, brother, I was going to Uber it. Now you can Uber it, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. But at least I got here. Now, would you have known that? No, I didn't have an intention to say it. But because the topic was that, and I said it. Sometimes it may show. I'm not angry. I'm not upset. And I hope nobody is. It was a way of dealing with the issue, such that we got here on time. MashaAllah. Subhanallah. And I enjoyed it. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters, remember, when we respect the scholars, we would actually be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because the deen comes to us through them. The deen comes to us through them. So even if you have a gripe against a scholar, even if there is something that has happened, when you want to raise it, do so respectfully. The problem today that we have, people, even amongst one another, when something bad has happened, they say, expose this person, do this to that. If you expose someone, fair and good. Allah will expose you. So one of the rights and the duties we have that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spoken about many times, he says, whoever covers the fault of a Muslim, Allah will cover their faults in this world and the next, and Allah will not embarrass them. So if you've been going around exposing people, wait for your day, it's coming. May Allah forgive us. But if you have, that does not mean don't deal with the problem. You may want to deal with it, but in a respectful manner, in a private way, in a way that you don't disturb the dignity of an individual. You know, imagine there was an imam in one of the masajid in one of the countries in southern Africa, and he was quite rough, and he used to know the community. The people started leaving the masjid one by one because he used to get up and say, you know, alcohol is very bad. This brother, and he would point at the brother, and he would say with his name, say his name was Yunus, for example. He says, brother Yunus, he's been drinking for 20 years. Please get up and tell us, what have you gained from that? Tell us what. And this brother's like, huh? What? So to correct such a scholar, you need, and wallahi, this is factual. What I've told you is real. He spoke about alcohol. He spoke about adultery. He says, you know, this person here, what he's been doing is very bad. Get up and tell us what's been going on. We're hearing a rumor. And he's like, what? Now they stop coming for Salatul Jumu'ah. So we got to deal with it because this is a big thing. But at the same time, deal with it respectfully. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. In this particular case, he was wrong to expose someone else, even to talk about them from a mimbar. Tell you why. People come to get closer to Allah, to learn something good, to be inspired. Why are you here today? Why are you here? You are here to be inspired, to get something good, to get closer to Allah, to feel when you leave here that today I learned something. Today I had a really good time and it was so nice. I enjoyed it. There were beautiful brothers and sisters, mashallah. We learned, we laughed at the same time, and we cried also. And we walked out of here better people. That's why you are here. Am I right?
Yes.
There you are. Imagine if I were to pick on one of you, two of you, make this whole thing a big embarrassment, you would go away saying, never again. Straight path, no way, not at all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and may He open our doors. So this is why we say we need to definitely respect one another. We need to be there for one another. We need to understand that just like we would love to be covered, we need to cover others. We should not expose them. Between husband and wife, there are more rights than there are for the general Muslims. Within your family, there are greater rights than there are within the general Muslim. Subhanallah. So let's try our best to fulfill this. There are still so many rights. And like I told you, I brought a list here. But I want to end with one. And this is one we are lacking. We're losing. Respecting those who are senior. That is a duty. Someone who's older than you, respect them. This person is older than me. That's why I'm quiet sometimes. That's why I've chosen a different way of doing things. Your mother, older than you, your father, your parents, how are you talking to them? Not only them, anyone who's older than you, even amongst us who are seated here. Imagine a young person, very fit, and they come and they sit down. And then there is a slightly older person, and they're struggling to walk a little bit, and you don't give your seat up for them. I've seen non-Muslims do this, meaning giving up their seats. What about us? It's an act of worship. You must respect the adults. But that doesn't mean that when they are wrong and they're instructing you to do something, that you obey, claiming that I'm respecting the older person. Or some older people use that to blackmail the younger ones to doing things that are wrong. I know some parents who use the status of a parent to blackmail the child to stop them from doing something Allah has allowed, such as getting married, for example. And they blackmail, I'm your parent. So what? Subhanallah. I will respect you, but it's within limits. So, two sides to the coin. I hope you've understood both. And to have mercy on those who are young. That's a duty. Someone is younger than you, have mercy. Teach them in a good way. Be patient with them. Your children, be very patient with them. Sometimes you have one child, mashallah, you enjoy the child, and you know the child might be running around, breaking this, destroying that, maybe doing this, that, whatever else. Then you have a second child, and suddenly, you know what, you're becoming a little bit more impatient. And then a third child, and you find that you cannot sleep at night sometimes, and you're getting up in the morning, and you're so tired. And what happens? You start getting upset and agitated. Control, control. Have mercy on these children. Have mercy on them. That is your test. That is your Jannah. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed this in your life purposefully, not for nothing. So my brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. I've really, like I said at the beginning, I've really enjoyed myself in the sense that being given such an opportunity to address all of you, even those who are listening to this perhaps online, and those who may hear it later on, may Allah bless you all. May Allah grant you all goodness. Let's work on these rights. I haven't covered all of them, but I've covered quite a few of them, and I've given myself and yourselves food for thought. And I pray that we can become better people. And we promise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here and now that we will definitely speak to one another in a better way. And we will learn to greet one another, no matter what race we are, what color we are, where we come from. Learn to smile and greet, and respond the greeting properly with a smile. So when someone says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, you don't just come and say, As-salam, as-salam. They said Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and they had a smile. So you go to say Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and you have to have the smile. That's the minimum, because that is replying equal. That's the minimum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us, grant us ease. I'd have loved to continue, but guess what? I've overshot my time by quite a bit. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.